according to last talk, we have in Poland a saying that everything depends on fantasy of logicians. So also cardinality, of course. Anyway, so we have talk outline is first introduction, kinds of modalities, logical square and its generalizations, interpretations of diagrams and philosophical issues. So we have several kinds of modalities, aletic, necessity, etc., truth, being obligator and so on. Kant contrasted assertoric, necessary and problematic sentences, and he did not regard assertoric as models. One can guess that this mistaken view blocked the development of modal logic in 19th century, deontic modalities, epistemic, known, guessed, certain, etc., erotetic, ask. And general form we have A is modal, or it is modal in a sense that A, sometimes with individual parameter, for example, A performs that A, this modality of doing, action, sometimes without it is necessary that A. We have also distinction between remark, the dicto, between the dicta and the re, predications. I will treat them as equivalent. It is true that A is true because I am speaking only about propositional modal logic, so this question how it is in predicate logic is maybe not relevant here. And symbolically, in order to you know, this open black box is like necessity, obligation and so on, and black diamond is like possibility and so on. Now we have first diagram, AB gamma delta, interpretation, we have A. I will speak about necessity because it is customary, but it is not aletic necessity only. Necessary that A, beta is necessary that not A, gamma is not necessary that not A, then delta is not necessary that A, it is the same like it is possible that not A. And we have standard relations, alpha implies beta, gamma, sorry, beta implies delta. It is like in square, better known square of categoric statements in Aristotle sense. So readings, necessity implies possibility, obligation implies permission, it is good implies that it is not so that A is bad. What is interesting is observe that gamma, possibility in wide sense, has no ordinary wording in some cases. For example, you have gamma, A is true implies that not A is not true. So, and they will extend this square to logical octagon. We have two new points, alpha or beta, it is V, and ni, gamma, and delta, and obvious connections that sorry, there's something wrong, so and logical octagon, hexagon, logical octagon, new point, namely kappa I lambda, we can read as A and not A. new relations are of course, for example, we and ni are contradictory, and so on. I assume that everybody knows this relation from classical logical square. Now we have why this elementary modal logic? Why elementary? Because I use only relations between logical. Coming from logical octagon, propositional relations, and there are unary modal operators, nothing more. So it is only part of standard modal logic, for example, system K, but of course not everything. First, interesting, and my guess and thesis is that we can clarify some traditional conceptual difficulties by looking at this elementary modal logic. For example, in deontic logic, we have a problem. What is permission? Yes. Gamma, so it is not prohibited than A, or ni, namely it is permitted that A and it is permitted that not A. And lawyers, for example, very frequently confuse these two notions. And they argue, for example, some deontic logicians, that the first understanding is not natural because what is obligatory is automatically permitted. But our intuition that obligation and permission should be separated. Of course, we can use another words that our action is free if I can do A and when I can do not A, but anyway, this is a problem which is in legal philosophy, for example, in moral philosophy, controversial. Now we have the rule, it is necessary that A is valid for necessity, aletic necessity and truth, but not for obligation and knowledge. So, hence the classical concept of knowledge, true justified belief, is not grounded in epistemic logic. What is interesting that the problem of invariance in elementary modal logic is not quite clear, because you see that this modal logic is not invariant over all modal operators. Now, if you adopt A implies these schemes obtain, because we have only it is true that A, then A. It reduces not T A to not at T not A, maybe we can say false in this case. Havel bivalence that is generalized V for truth is not a logical truth contrary to A or alpha or delta, A is true or not A is true. Consequently, the logic of diagrams does not exclude many valueness or truth value gaps. This confirms Łukasiewicz view that the principle of bivalence is metalogical and adopted on extra-logical grounds, not purely logical. Leśniewski in his prototetic has the principle of bivalence as a logical theorem, but it assumes extensionality and T-scheme. Truth is lacking the models in this sense, if you adopt T-scheme, truth is lacking modal status. It's in the Dali since formula A implies it is true that A, it is, this formula is responsive for paradoxes. We have some material to explain how pure logic is involved into semantic troubles. Now is an interesting case. Unfortunately, I have not enough time to elaborate. It is so-called it is so-called negative theory of malum, accepted by Aquinas. He says that wrongness is not negativum, but rather a privativum. Unfortunately, nobody explained sufficiently clearly what are privativa. However, this theory is also related to very beautiful medieval idea, namely theory of transcendentals. We have so-called over-categorial concept. Yeah, according to Plato's statement, transcendentalia omnia genera transcendens are not kinds, but something over kinds. And we have next thesis is that over-categorial general concepts has various peculiar instances expressed by Latin statements like ens et verum converturtur, ens et bonum converturtum, and verum et bonum converturtum. And now negative theory of malum is connected with second statement. These being and goodness are convertible. Its application to the problem of evil is immediate. Clearly, malum opposes bonum. Hence, if being and goodness are convertible, malum is negative, and according to negative theory of malum, does not exist because it is not a being at all. This is a very brave thesis. So, what is malum? This is also a theological question. As I already noted, malum is rather a privativum with respect to bonum, but not its negativum. Disregarded various points which differ negative and privative, in particular metaphysical issues, let me only remark that logically speaking, if X is a positivum and Y constitutes its negativum, both are contradictories. On the other hand, related positive and privativa are contraries. Now the fundamental claim of negative theory of malum states that malum and bonum are contraries as privativa. This statement, as well as the convertibility thesis, are the basic core of NTM. Now, and we have some, of course, problems. This is, in my view, it is a very counterintuitive theory, which claims that if A is an ens, then A is a bonum. This is a controversial thesis because it assumes that there are no wrong beings. Beings are only good. Of course, in theology, malum comes from human action. The reason for this theory was theologically ordained to save God from responsibility for evil in the world. However, logically speaking, this idea has no justification in pure logic, maybe in theology, but I don't enter into this this issue. So there are another thesis that everything is bonum, everything is malum. This is also theory known from early medieval, from later antiquity. Yes, malum is the only positivum. Also Nietzsche accepted, Schopenhauer accepted this. This view, which is not without empirical justification, if you look at the history, every object is good or wrong, so there is no neutral object, axiologically neutral. Every object is indifferent, so nature is neither good nor wrong, so values are imposed by us. For example, emotivism, and probably the most plausible view from ordinary point of view, some objects are good, some wrong, and some indifferent. So logic suggests few theories of bonum and malum, of course, doesn't solve which is correct. Some Thomists, even contemporary, say that logic can defend Aquinas' view, what is rather a very brave thesis. Now, the Hume thesis, which was mentioned today, but with connection of causality, is a famous thesis that Hume observed in his thesis on human nature, that is does not entail ought. So we cannot derive any obligation, moral or legal, from purely descriptive of existential statements. Is a famous passage from this book. And if you look at Octagon, this thesis finds its full logical justification in logic generated by our ontagon. Point lambda is separated from being obligatory and also from being permitted. So if we can generalize Hume thesis for any deontic modalities. So is doesn't entail that something is obligatory, prohibited, indifferent, not permitted, and so on. So logically speaking, the world in which everything is obligatory or prohibited, this is a dream of all bureaucrats, yes, is logically possible. And also the opposite world in which everything is indifferent. So there are even some jokes about countries and relations to this situation. So this typical democracy, American or British, is that something is not if something is not prohibited, it is permitted. German style is if something is not permitted, it is prohibited. In Poland was a joke that two persons met and discussed what they did during war, and I was in Polish underground movement. And you? Not, it was prohibited. So, determinism, next interesting case. So, because it's simply that determinism is a view that everything is causally determined, yes, but it's not the only. Every A is determined, every not A is determined or anti-determined, and so on. Every A is contingent. Some A are determined, some A are anti-determined, some A are contingent. And we can formalize. So we have several possibilities, ontological possibilities. For example, the view of Jan Łukasiewicz that classical logic entails radical determinism is misunderstanding. It cannot do that. So omniscience is next question. How to define omniscience? For example, as a theological property of God. And now logical issues in this section, modalities are applied to sets of sentences, not single utterances. Let gamma be a set of sentences in order to eliminate some inessential complications. We assume that gamma, if consistent, is different from. I will not skip this. We have the following relation. Truth implies consistency. It is obvious very, very frequently. It was argued that a set of two sentences must be consistent. And then we have inconsistency implies falsehood, which is not quite clear. Yeah, she protests, a paraconsistent logician. Yeah. I am working in classical logic. Consistency truth and inconsistency are contraries, consistency and falsehood are complementaries, truth and falsehood are contradictories, and consistency and inconsistency are also contradictories. And now it is too poor description. More interesting if we introduce the concept of omega consistency and omega inconsistency. It is only for arithmetical theories. I will not enter into definition. You see, and we have that omega consistency entails consistency, inconsistency entails omega inconsistency, omega consistency and inconsistency are contraries, consistency and omega inconsistency are complementaries, and omega consistency and omega inconsistency are contradictories. Consistency are and inconsistency are contradictories. The reason for 22 is that inconsistency entails everything. Theories which are consistent and omega inconsistent are just a case in which it points. So, you know, Gödel's first theorem, first version, was that if arithmetic is consistent, so the theorem I am provable is not, maybe not, not provable, but it, if it is inconsistent, so omega consistent, sorry, then negation of Gödel's sentence is provable. So it is a question in which sense we speak about consistent and omega inconsistent theories. It was a surprise, I guess, for logicians that this fact was elaborated, and since that time some people worry which concept of consistency is proper, simple consistency or omega consistency. So you see that there are regular connections, regular modal connections between this group of concepts. However, then we know that if we take, for example, as Gödel sentence, mathematics is omega inconsistent, yes, so we obtain, it is true in non-standard model. So this all concepts, all settings are now dependent on our convention maybe or view. What is standard? Which interpretation is considered as standard? Ordinary example. It was by Hilary Putnam. He worried that what if the sentence snow is white means green is grass is green, that then Tarski's scheme fails. We discussed with him this issue several times. Look, this is non-standard interpretation of ordinary words, so nothing happens, simply nothing. You changed standard interpretation of our ordinary language, you are free as an American pragmatist. However, it doesn't matter to interpretation of Tarski's scheme, and I think that the last slide is related to maybe my yesterday talk, namely that if we elaborate an interpretation of a language, a formalized or a formal language, and we want to say something related to customary meaning of our language, so the pragmatic flavor is unavoidable. Simply in metalanguage, always we have some pragmatic constraints, for example, whether, whether we work with second order arithmetic or first order arithmetic and so on. And several interesting things depend on such choices, for example, the existence of non-standard models, categoricity, and so on. So I think that this fact should be taken into account. Even I have no time, had no time to discuss Gila's paper, that there are important things for even invariance and necessity. For example, last sentence is that logic doesn't distinguish any extra logical content. This is a base for invariance. It was proved by Lindenbaum and Tarski, and then generalized by Polish logician after. However, we have still difference between propositional calculus, pure predicate logic, and predicate logic with identity. It is very difficult to say that this last system doesn't distinguish any logical content, because we can define models with special cardinalities. Thank you.